I should plug my extension cord into this lamppost right here, run my 100-foot wire all the way across to Morehouse's Park, and rock the house. All right?
Where did this come from? How did this start? I think it was the aspect of the park jams smashing open the base of the streetlight and plugging in to the city's power. It was like, yeah. Because, you know, the thing was, where are you going to get the power? So the fact that we were kind of taking the power was hot.
Hip-hop would have never been invented if everybody around it was rich, because it was a music that was made with existing music.
People still wanted to get involved with music. And they made something out of nothing.
It was against the mainstream. It was totally do-it-yourself.
It was brand new. No one had seen anything like that.
These young kids came from poverty and desolation and conquered the world.
The first time I came aware on hip-hop music is probably when I came from Haiti. My first pit stop was Marlboro Projects by Coney Island. These guys used to be passing with these cars, and the speakers were so loud, I was like, these guys are gonna be deaf in a week. First bass line I heard from a car was probably boom, 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 boom. Automatically, you just fall in love with the vibe.
One of the very, very first rap records was also a huge international smash, and that was Rapper's Delight by the Sugar Hill Gang. I said a hip hop, the hip, the hip me to the hip, hip hop, you don't stop the rocket to the bang bang boogie, say up, jump the boogie to the rhythm of the boogie to beat.
The world heard my voice first to usher in a new genre of music. And me, the groove,
and my friends are gonna try to move. When you heard Rapper's Delight come on at the club, it was like, what is these cats doing, man? It's just something about this connects right to my soul. They speak in my language. After school, I take a dip in the pool, which is really on the wall.
I got a color TV so I can see the Knicks play basketball.
When I first started hearing rap and hearing color TV so I could see the Knicks play basketball, it's like, oh, okay. If I was making records, I'd probably talk about that too.
They was talking about how much fun they was having, how fly they looked it, and it just was different. It was just a brand new sound.
We were officially into what is known now as a hip-hop era. Everything would change from that point on.
What we're gonna do right here is go back, back into time.
It's a Desi Des and a KCK, the D5. We gonna rock the place. And if you're based in the place, you will get disgraced because we are the
hip-hop is an art form that came from the South Bronx. You know what I'm saying?
Bronx in the late 70s was the American poster child for urban decay. There were blocks and blocks that were decimated and rubble strewn. There was poverty, there was drug abuse, there was hopelessness, there was joblessness.
The South Bronx is different. It's a world of its own, you know what I'm saying? Nobody wants to come here, you know, nobody wants to live here. You would never thought it'd come out of some place like this. Just like the pain.
When I was in the house, I heard a shot, and they put a man by a car, and he was dead, and the cops came this morning, and he was on the floor.
It was so notorious that in 1979 or 1980, when Ronald Reagan was first running for office, he visited the Bronx as a way of just expressing his astonishment at how bad things could be.
I haven't seen anything that looked like this since London after the Blitz.
It looked like the aftermath of a war.
kind of dope for us, Mr. Rap?
I'm trying to tell you, Ron.
What can you do? What can you do? What you can do? But we're bad.
Why don't you push? I'm not going to hit him. Are you crazy?
Hip-hop develops in a very interesting time because you had the changes afforded black folks because of the civil rights movement. But at the same time, locally, New York City goes into a terrible financial crisis. Cutbacks had to go across the board. All sorts of social programs were cut. You know, the first thing to usually go are the arts programs. So the little black kid with the trumpet who's 9 years old. Sorry, we're taking your trumpet away, Rakim. But those young people didn't give up.
People was just desperate to have something to go crazy about. And out of nowhere came that B-boy. You know what I'm saying? The B-boy dancing. The rapping on the mic. The DJs. You know what I'm saying? The South Bronx. The place where you never thought it would happen. It happened right here.
VH1 Hip Hop Honor, celebrating 30 years of hip hop culture.
Stomp the beat. Hip hop really broke out in the South Bronx in New York City.
In the Bronx, people started to look at old turntables and say, hey, maybe we can actually make music out of the records that's happened to be laying around. And they made something out of nothing.
The word went around without the use of radio, no flyers. It was just word of mouth that this guy, Clive Campbell, went by the name of Kool Herc, was coming out in the park. You had to go see this guy.
In 1974, I went to a party and I saw this DJ named Kool Herc. I knew from that day on, that's what I want to do, for real.
This guy would bring this setup outside to what was called a block party. And he'd have these huge speakers, this huge, huge setup.
Kool Herc, he played in this park and slam packed this park with 3,000-4,000 people. You know what I'm saying? So this is Cedar Park on Cedric Avenue. This is where Kool Herc did his first block party, right here, y'all.
My name is DJ Kool Herc. Origin, West Indian from Jamaica. Jamaican music was a big influence on me too because there's a lot of big sound system. Used to hook up and play in the weekend. I took that attitude behind the turntable, giving the people on the floor what they're supposed to be hearing.
Kool Herc to shout your name out on the mic, that mean you was like a celebrity yourself, because he was big in the South Bronx. And I was thinking of ways just to get up in his face. You know what I'm saying? And I ran into this guy that had the record, James Brown, Sex Machines, collector's item. Come on, stay on the scene, like a sex machine. And I went up to Herc and I said, Herc, I have something you would want. He said, what do you have? I said, I have the record, Sex Machine. He said, how much you want for it? I said, I don't want no money. I just want you to shout my name on the mic, man, so I could tape it and take it back to the hood and let the girls know that Kool Herc shouted me out. You know what I'm saying? I want to count it off one more time now. Go ahead. You want to hit it like it did on the top, fellas? Hit it like it did on the top.
Hit it now. At the time, the radio was playing songs like Donna Summers, The Tramps, The Bee Gees. Disco stuff, you know. Do the
hustle. People that was growing up in the hood, we didn't really have the financial backing to attend these big bashes. I knew the majority of people wanted to go because disco is so popular. So what we had to do, we had to make our own disco.
Hip-hop came out with its use of disco. The disco era was almost like the belief in the 12-inch record. And the 12-inch meant extended play, which means that the music can go on and on and on to the break of dawn.
the whole DJ thing evolved from the DJs in the disco, from everybody from Kool Herc to Grandmaster Flash, Grand Wizard Theodore. It was like, let's keep the good part of the record and let's vibe off of that.
Herc used to just play records at random. When the record go off or the beat get ready to go, he just slap another one on, not particularly on time, but you know, other DJs came in, you know, like Flash, started cutting on time, so you never have to stop dancing.
One thing about Flash, Flash was a DJ. Kool Herc was a record player. Oh, no. Yeah, let that play.
My thing was, to every great record, there was a great part. And this is what we used to call the get down part. This is before it was tagged the break.
It takes two to make a thing go right.
And this particular part of the record, unjustifiably, was like 5 seconds, maybe less. Kind of pissed me off. I was like, damn, why'd they do that? So mathematically, I was saying to myself, well, if I can figure out how to take the music that I love, where the break was so short, extend them particular sections and make them as long as I chose to, that would really be the way to go. If I were to say it in a language that today's people could understand, I would have to say that I was a manual sampler.
Flash's great innovation was extending the disco break, but one of the other tremendous innovations was scratching, and that was created by Grand Wizard Theodore, who was a protege of Flash.
Just on one particular day, I was in the house practicing, and the music was a little bit too loud. So my moms came and banged on the door and said, if you don't turn that music down, you're going to turn it off. And she had the door open, and while she was talking to me, I was still holding the record. I was like, wow, this really sounds like something, you know. And I practiced with it and perfected it and used different records, and that's when it became a scratch.
You got to remember, hip-hop started off behind the DJ. It didn't start off behind the rapper. And Flash and the early DJs, Grand Wizard Theodore and them, they said, here, take the mic, tell everybody how great I am.
The MC was the guy who, like, shouted out the DJ and announced a lot of the upcoming parties for the DJ, because the DJ was the man, you know what I'm saying? The MC was just like the help, you know what I'm saying? $100 night man, you know what I'm saying? Things like that. But as time went on, they started getting more creative.
I was the guy that set it all off. I was the, you know, such as they say now, set it off. I mean, get it going, get it happening, getting it live.
On my verses when I was rapping, when I got lost for words, I used to say hip hop, the hip hip, hop, the hop, the hop, hip it, hip it, hip. Then you rock the hip. Then you rock the hop, and you make sure, you know, and when, and you know, that pretty much stuck with me.
I walked in Charles Gallery in Harlem, and there was a rapper by the name of Eddie Cheever, and he was spitting rhymes, and people were responding to him. He said, who make it sweeter? Cheever, Cheever, Cheever.
Say, who makes it sweeter?
To us.
rappers, that's where it started, with the crowd motivation, where we say things and the crowd would say things back, and somebody say, ho, oh, let me hear somebody scream.
Clap your hands, everybody. Everybody clap them hands. Come on, y'all. Just keep your partner and stay on the floor. We're going to do it a little like an eel. We continue on with the music, y'all. It's time for you to be real. You
see, first person I heard rhyming was DJ Hollywood. His whole thing was, get the bun out your back, you know, call and response type of thing.
Get the bun out your back, boy! Get the bun out your back, girl!
And he had like a real exaggerated type of voice. It's not a bird, it's not a plate, it's plate as you can see, that kind of thing.
Just skip, you hug, you don't stop. Everybody come on, let's body rock. Now I rock the freak and I freak the rock. Now I'm playing the music and I just can't stop.
This was a party. And these are people going crazy, screaming and sweating. And I'm on the mic and it's like Simon says, whatever I say, do, they're doing. People are like, what the hell is this? This was the beginning of hip-hop.
Hip-hop's a culture that's based around DJing, rapping, graffiti, and breakdancing. But it's a way of life. It's a vibe.
It's a similar kind of rush that you have at a party, at a jam in a park, under the stars, going out, sneaking into the yards, the idea of painting your name, and just the attitude that went behind a lot of it, you know, it's basically us against them.
Response to these kids being marginalized. This was their way of saying, we are not nobodies, we are somebody. So I'll put a giant burner on a train, and this train's gonna go all over the city. And that to me is what hip hop is all about. It's really, look at me.
It's a matter of bombing, knowing that I can do it, you know? Every time I get in the train, almost every day I see my name. I say, yeah, you know what? I was there. I bombed it.
Should be clean, and the ones that are caught should be cleaned. They should clean it, the ones that they catch on doing that.
Gives a terrible impression of the city.
The response that I think a repeater, three-time repeater, should get would be 5 days in jail.
Graffiti artists, we knew that we were like bandits. We were outlaws, the way we can steal into the subway system, do incredible works of art, and get out unscathed.
Is that an art form? I don't know. I'm not an art critic. But I can sure as hell tell you that that's a crime. Jessica, Jessica,
Jessica. What'd you do last night? We did two whole cars. It was me, Dez, and me, three, right? And on the first car, in small letters, it said, all you see is, and then, you know, big black silver letters, it said, crime in the city.
The South Bronx that I knew was a very dangerous place. You know what I'm saying? I mean, if you wasn't in a certain gang, or you hung out on the wrong street corner, I mean, anything could happen, you know what I'm saying?
Gang culture was strong in New York. It was violent, and it was dangerous.
I got into street gangs, the Black Spades, a lot of other groups I was in before I became a Spade, Power Bronx, Savage Nomads.
Afrika Bambaataa, who was a gangster, might have been the first to realize how foolish it was to continue in this way.
Afrika Bambaataa is an MC. He is a DJ. He is a graph writer, he is a b-boy. But Afrika Bambaataa back in the days introduced the concept of peace, love, unity, and having fun.
It's the Bronx in the house! Is everybody in the house?
He pretty consciously tried to redirect the energy that had gone into gangsterism into hip-hop.
The Zulu Nation was an organization that Bambaataa put together whose purpose was to put on these parties.
So instead of fighting each other with, you know, guns and knives and fists, your crew would battle this other crew, but you would do it with records, and you would do it on the mic, and you would do it by dancing.
When the breakbeat part of the record came on, guys would just drop to the floor and start doing these crazy moves. And it would almost seem like a fight had broken out. So people would gather around like they were watching a fight.
Who won the rocking contest? Steady. Dynamic Rockers. Hold it down. It was a tie.
Hip-hop has always been competitive. And it's always been about a battle. You know, whether you talk about graffiti, or you talk about b-boying or breakdancing, or you talk about rapping, or you talk about emceeing, it's always, I'm better than you.
Well, I'm the R.
Ruby D.
And you got a lot of nerve. When you play against me, you know you're gonna get served.
Cold Crush.
JDL, the Lords of Lords, and Ruby D, my man, your is on the boards.
I never heard 4 and 5 MCs with 2 DJs battling each other for supremacy. I was like, oh my God, what's going on here?
Well, I'm the M.
That's right.
Like all the pretty girls, I serve your monkey ass like Earl the Pearl.
So, Crush. I'm Master Cass or GMC. I'm gonna stick it on the board, man. Can't you see?
Cold Crush was the whole manifestation of what hip hop was about. It changed my life.
Ashes to ashes and dust to dust. We are the brothers, don't ask the Cold Crush. Not one, not two, not three, but four. We keep your arms in the air, your feet on the floor. Guaranteed to give you what you paid your money for, but the Cold Crush brothers got problems.
Just watching entertainers, period. You know how they deal with the audience and crowd. I learned a lot, just absorbed it all, and then, you know, hip hop was my release for it.
And then I slipped away to make a phone call this very day. It was a move I regret, but it didn't know then, so I called me back.
It wasn't about the show and be happy. It was about making the dark, rough, violent, smoked out, reefer selling, gun selling party, making that feeling. But I never heard nothing like this before. Early hip hop was a machine. It required DJs, it required dancers, it required rappers. When Sylvia Robinson went out and took the Sugar Hill Gang, which was really a Spice Girl rap group, a group that was made up of non-rappers, and said, you can make a record of this stuff, kids weren't thinking about that. This was just something to have fun.
Rap on record was completely revolutionary, and it was something that had never really occurred to the folks who'd been in the game as rappers prior to that moment. It took Sylvia Robinson, who was an older woman and an entrepreneur and an artist in the rock and roll era, to make it happen.
I never knew anything about rap at that time, but my niece was giving a birthday party for me, and I saw this DJ playing music, and he was saying things to the kids, and they would answer him back. And I says, oh my God, that's a great idea. And I felt a spirit in me that said, you put a concept like that on record, and you'll go to the moon.
What she did was very, very ballsy. Not only did she conceive of making a rap record, but she also assembled her own rap group.
Just like I put the Moments together in the 70s, I put Sugar Hill Gang together. Big Bang Hank, he was working at the pizza parlor.
Hank closed up the pizza shop and jumped in Ms. Rob's car and started auditioning right there with flour all over him and everything. And then Master G was walking down the street. G gets in the car and starts auditioning.
In fact, they had their own names like Master G, Wonder Mike, but they didn't know each other.
She was, you know, gracious enough to say, okay, let me hear what you got. And I said, the hip, top, the hibbit, the hibby, dibby, hibby, hibba. And she said, what? And I started incorporating everything I saw, from the dog to the statue to the library books. And she said, that was pretty cool. So that was kind of like the opening hook.
I said, the hip, the hip, hip, the hip, hip, hop, you don't stop the rocket to the bang, bang, boogie, say up, jump the boogie to the rhythm of the boogie to beat.
I knew all crews, what they were doing, when they were doing it, and where they were doing it. But strangely enough, in 79, there was this record to the hip hop, the hibbity-bi. I'm like, well, hold up. Who are these people?
Sylvia just got three people that she could mold together. Oh, predates the boy band thing. Let me find three people that I could put together and start a group.
There was no Sugar Hill Gang. They had no history. They seemed like interlopers.
One person I know to be a bouncer, and some of the rhymes that he was saying, I heard from Cold Crush, Grandmaster Caz.
At the time, Rappers Delight came out, you know, a lot of hip-hop people were pretty salty about it because, you know, these guys weren't really a hip-hop group and the rhymes came from Grandmaster Caz, and it was phony in a sense.
Big Bang Hank from the Sugar Hill Gang. He got down with us as acting manager. He took a loan out from his parents to buy us a bigger set. He had to get a job in New Jersey to pay back the loan. So that's where the Sugar Hill people asked him to be down on this record they were doing. Personally, I was shocked because Hank is not an MC. You know, he was the manager. So I would figure that he would say, well, I'm not an MC, but I manage these guys that's on this tape, but whatever.
Kaz and the Cold Crush were sitting there wondering, well, why didn't they just come to us and make a record? Now, how come we're left out of it?
I figured if something comes out of it, I guess we're next. So he said, you know, I want to use some of your rhymes. I just threw a book on the table and said, whichever, you know, whatever you want to use. You know, that turned out to be I'm the C-A-S and the O-V-A-N.
I'm the C-A-S and the O-V-A and the rest is F-L-Y. You see, I go by the code of the doctor of the mix. And these reasons, I'll tell you why.
Big Pink Hank starts his second verse like saying someone else's name. I'm pretty sure that Sylvia wasn't too threatened. It's not like he would go out and hire a high-powered lawyer.
I got bodyguards, I got two big guards that definitely ain't the whack. I got a Lincoln Continental and some new Cadillac.
You could talk all you want about how, oh man, I'm not with Rapper's Delight, that's not a cool record, but people were still playing it at the party and people were still dancing. I mean, that's something that hip-hop has always struggled with, but rappers have found that if you can make a popular record that makes people dance, that's most of the battle right there.
You cannot deny the fact that Sugar Hill Gang was the first big rap group, and if we don't get any respect from someone, screw them. We open the doors for a lot of people.
Do it, do it, do it. And I'm here, and I'm there. I'm Big Bang Hank, I'm everywhere.
It sold like crazy. It was a top five record all over Europe, also in the Far East. It was just this phenomenal thing.
When I heard Rapper's Delight, I was just in heaven. Because you could understand all of the words that were being said, so it was very easy for me to catch on and rhyme along with it.
Say the hip hop, the hip hop, the hip hop, the hip hop.
There was something that connected that I could do that. That was a time when every kid had a rap with their name in it. You know, and everybody had one that started at the age of one. I had just begun on my journey to the T.O.P., you know.
All I know is that this changed the game of hip-hop. This record just set the goal to a whole nother level now. It wasn't rule the Bronx or rule Manhattan or rule whatever. It was now, how soon can you make a record?
For more, log on.
The minute hip-hop turned into a record, the culture changed. What had been this little homegrown cottage industry all of a sudden could go anywhere a record went. The making of rap records changed everything.
Rapper's Delight was perceived as a novelty record. The next major feat would be to get a major label interested.
You give me all that jive about things you wrote before I was alive. Cause this ain't 1823, ain't even 19.
Curtis Blow record, Christmas rapping. We put it on vinyl cause no one wanted to buy it. And we put the vinyl in the street. And when it got hot on the street, Mercury Records called us. That's how Curtis Blow got signed in 1979.
Curtis Blow was the first real hip-hop star.
Yeah!
We called him the king of rap. Every time somebody else got hot, they had to book Curtis Blow because he was the king. And it kept us hot for a while. It helped us to develop a real stable career for Curtis.
Bring it up, bring it up, bring it up!
He didn't have a lot of rap skills, but he was like a ladies' man, you know what I'm saying? Like an idol. Come out with them Jerry curls and them high heel boots like Prince and just rock the house, you know what I'm saying? He had a lot of crowd response to his You know his music, though. Say, oh, somebody scream.
Somebody scream. Breakdown.
Curtis Blow is one of my favorite, you know, his voice and the tracks he would rap on. In a lot of ways, I saw him as being ahead of his time. He was a superstar to me.
Breaks on the stage, breaks on the screen, breaks to make your wallet lean. Breaks run cold and breaks run hot. Some folks got him and some have not, but these are the breaks. Break it up, break it up, break it up, break down.
At that particular time, there were a lot of mom and pop shop record companies that wanted to get on this bandwagon. I guess I'd never forget, there was this real wrinkled old guy in the back of my club. One, he could either be the police, or he was somebody's father looking for their daughter, one or the other. Either one, I just definitely did not want to get entangled with. He eventually stepped to me after a party or two and asked, would I like to make a record? His name is Bobby Robinson of Enjoy Records. Sha-da-da! The record was called Super Rappin'.
All through my high school, people used to sell tapes. The way CDs and albums sell, I was just focused on the tapes. But then Flash put out Super Rappin'. My brother Alfred brought it home, and I put it on, and it just hypnotized me. I just remember introducing the crew, you're gonna see to believe. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 MCs.
Introducing the crew, you gotta see to believe. We're 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 MCs. I'm Melly Mel, and I'm rocking so well.
And I'm Mr. Ness because I rocks the best.
I'm Raheem Hutt in all the.
Then from there, he had gotten sort of bought to Sugar Hill.
I was looking for a group that could really be hardcore. They auditioned for me, and I liked it.
What Sugar Hill did very cannily was that they went out and got Grandmaster Flash and Furious 5, Treacherous 3, which included Kumo D, Sequence, the first female rappers. They had something, have a roster, you know, of artists, and they have some that have credibility. But the Sugar Hill Gang didn't have credibility in the hip-hop world. Certainly Grandmaster Flash and Furious 5 did, and Funky 4 Plus 1 were great.
I think one thing that's important to hit on is the amazing MCs ever, male or female.
We do it for the girl, for the boy, the man. Most people go around just thinking anyway. We want you to hear what we say. The things we say, the things we do. It's like running a race and the lone compute. That's a lie, the competition to be.
Because
we are the ones.
The first community of people to really embrace rap, breakdance, and graffiti as an art form was this sort of East Village downtown world.
We'd be going to see punk rock shows and going to clubs where they play like punk rock and new wave or whatever records. And then as soon as like hip hop made a transition to records and you started hearing like, you know, Funky 4 Plus 1 More, Treacherous 3 or Spoonie G or whatever, those records started to play in those same downtown clubs and we loved it. That was really the transition where so many people became aware of all these different elements of hip hop culture.
They saw hip-hop as a black version of the punk new wave aesthetic.
There was some kind of a similarity between the punk scene and the hip-hop scene in that, you know, it was sort of the underground, you know, the underdog barking loudly.
The similarities between punk rock and hip-hop was something that I noticed early on, just seeing the way CBGB's was tagged up, like all the graffiti on the walls from different bands. And I felt like there was a connection between what was going on with that, simultaneously what was going on with hip hop. And that eventually led me to meet people from the punk scene, like Debbie Harry, Chris Stein, the group Blondie.
We met up with Freddie down at CBC, came down and somehow or other, you know, we got to be friends.
We kind of set up what I call a cultural exchange. We went up to the PAL at 183rd and Webster, which was like a typical spot in the Bronx where hip-hop would go down.
I am the New Yorker, the street walker, the women stalker.
I don't think any group of white people had ever ventured to something like this. You know, the streets were real edgy at the time, you know what I'm saying? There was a popular dance on the scene at the time on the hip-hop scene called the Patty Duke, which is based on this TV show from way back in the days.
I could never sort of figure out. I thought it was some kind of sort of semi-robotic movement, you know? But I thought, you know, great for Patty, really.
And I was just hoping, like, oh my God, here I am. I got this group of white people with me. I hope nothing happens, you know what I mean? Because, and I remember we was walking in, and I was kind of standing right near Debbie, and this one kid kind of looked over, and he said, yo, man, look, that's Patty Duke. We would kind of joke around and stuff like that, and I kind of told her, you should make a record about me. And she just joked and laughed, you know? Chris and Debbie played the record Rapture for me at their house, but they played it and they had these big smiles on their faces.
Fat Five Freddy told me everybody's fly. DJ spinning, I said, my. Flash is fast, flash is cool. Francois, c'est pas, flash ain't no do. And you don't stop, shoot shot, go out to
the... I think the content of the rap in Rapture was definitely an homage to the form and the people that we knew that, you know, introduced us to it and became part of our world.
I thought, oh, wow, that's so cool. They just did this, like, as a little throwaway, fun thing. I never knew it was supposed to have been on their album. So I'm in Paris about a month or so later, and the record came on the radio in the cab, and it was like, wait, what is this? Like, who's playing this record? It would play all the time back then, you know, it was just huge. The record Rapture was a pretty big hit, you know, it was number one around the world. It's not in any way a hip-hop record, but it was definitely like the first time mainstream or most of America heard an inkling of rap, you know what I'm saying? Like, this was like a little appetizer, I guess, for the explosion that was about to happen.
There's no other record like that. People listen to that on the corner, on the radio. It was a year in, year out hit over and over and over again. And every time you heard it, it still felt like a new sensation.
It was like this weird punk record that was funky, but it wasn't like punk. It was like this mixture of all these things that I loved. It was like, whoever made this for me. This is exactly what I need.
We was trying to reach the black, Latino, and the punk rock white community. But then the song just blew up. We started traveling, and that's where we started pushing our ideology of the universal Zulu nation on a world level.
Afrika Bambaataa did the first worldwide tours where people was like, what is that? If Afrika Bambaataa had said, it's called Gubaguda, that's what we'd be here talking about. He said, it's called hip hop. Now we're here talking about hip hop.
1982 was a seminal year in hip hop. Two very important moments would be the release of Planet Rock, and then of course, you know, the message by Grandmaster Flash and the Furious Five. It's like a jungle sometimes, it makes you wonder how I keep going under. Hey, it's
like a jungle sometimes, it makes you wonder how. Hey fellas, what you wanna do? I had the message 2 years before I ever met them. And I said, I have a song here. If you do this, it will make you bigger than you've ever been. And so then I played it. And they say, we used to doing party songs.
We more or less was like used to all of the break records. You know, these things that had beats in them that, you know, drove people, you know what I'm saying? We heard the message. It was like,
we actually didn't want to do it. We was afraid of the song. But Sylvia, she had a concept of us doing that song, and she felt that we would be, you know, perfect for it because we came from, like, the inner city.
I knew the message would work as a rap because of the story. Most people living in the ghetto, that's their story, story of their life.
Up until then, rap was more of a party sound. We'd brag about stuff, you know, having solid gold cars and silly stuff and women and things. Then a message came out, and it was a lyrical portrayal of what was happening in the inner city.
Standing on the front stoop, hanging out the window, watching all the cars go by.
That was the first time I could see, okay, they're talking about street things, you know, roaches and rats. And I was like, oh, that's cool. And they're making, like, telling a story about what's going on the street, but it was funky.
A child is born with no state of mind, blind to the ways of mankind. God is
when I heard Melly Mel sing the message, it changed my life.
You'll grow in the ghetto living second rate, and your eyes will sing a song of deep hate.
He just sounded like some prophet.
And it was like, finally, somebody's telling the world how we live and what we're going through.
Don't push me, cause I'm close to the edge.
That is hip-hop. If you ever want to know what the consciousness of hip-hop is, it's summarized in that statement. Don't push me, cause I'm already close to the edge. I'm just trying not to lose my head.
I just want to say thank you to all the forefathers of hip-hop, man, everybody.
Really, if it wasn't for them, then we wouldn't even be here today.
Kool Herc was number one.
Kool Herc.
Kool Herc.
Kool Herc.
Kool Herc.
Bam.
Bambaataa.
Africa Bambaataa.
Then came the Grandmaster Flash.
Grandmaster Flash.
Grandmaster Flash.
DJ Hollywood.
Hollywood. Eddie Cheeba.
Eddie Cheeba.
Eddie Cheeba.
Then came Pete DJ Jones.
Pete DJ Jones.
Pete DJ Jones.
Sugar Hill Gang.
Sugar Hill Gang.
Sugar Hill Gang.
Rocksteady Crew.
Rocksteady.
New York City Breakers.
Mature 2000.
Scene.
My man Lee Quinones.
DJ AJ Lovebug Starsky.
Busy B.
Cowboy.
The Creole.
Young Mel.
Melly Mel.
Fantastic Five.
The L Brothers. With Theodore,
the L Brothers,
Grandmaster Kaz,
Kaz and the Cold Crush,
the Cold Crush,
Cold Crush 4,
the Cold Crush,
Charlie Chase,
Cold Crush,
and Tony Tone,
Kumo D,
Kumo D, and Treacherous 3,
Treacherous 3,
Treacherous 3,
Spoonie G,
Breakout and Baron, and the Funky Four,
Funky Four,
Mario, God bless the dead, he was there too.
To all of the guys that paved the way.
VH1 Hip Hop Honors celebrating 30 years.